types of upper lip lifts. Let's get into that. So there are ones that are temporary, okay? And these are the non-surgical options. These include plasma lip lift, thread lip lift, Botox lip flip, and lip filler. So plasma is just one of these little plasma energy pens that you may have seen. They create these little tiny dots all around the area that that's being treated, and over time those little burn marks heal up, and it's meant to sort of tighten and lift the lip. It doesn't really do a whole lot. Haven't really seen much improvement with that, but it is an option. In terms of temporary lip lifts, we talked about those. Thread lip lifts, again, people are putting threads all around the face. Short-lived effects, in my opinion, maybe boosts a bit of collagen, but limited efficacy. Botox lip flip, so that's something that is getting a little bit more popular. I think it's an option. It's not an incredible dramatic improvement, but it's something. So basically you take Botox or Jeuveau, any neuromodulator, and you inject usually 4 points along the vermilion. So like here, and here, right? So just like one unit in each of those points, right at the vermilion, not deep, very superficial. It paralyzes a portion of the orbicularis oris muscle, or the muscle that runs around the mouth. And in doing so, it kind of raises the upper red lip just a touch, maybe by about a millimeter. That's not a bad option, but just like all Botox, it lasts about 3 to 4 months, then it's gone. So you'll have to keep coming back for it. The injections are a little bit painful, actually, because it's a sensitive area. Someone just asked, prefer temporary lip lift options. So the fourth one, which is probably the most common, is lip filler. So this is something we're all familiar with, right? Lip filler is taking either like Juvederm or Restylane, injecting it along the lip, whether it's upper lip or the bottom lip, and also trying to create more red lip show, shorter philtrum. And someone asked, do you put filler in the lower lip to even out lips after? That's a great question. So that's something I don't really go into on my page that much, so I'll talk about it now. A lot of people ask about that, right? They're saying, if you're just doing the surgery on my upper lip, then what about my lower lip? But what happens is, what people don't realize is the lower lip usually is bigger than the upper lip, even if it's not totally obvious at first. And what I find also, that after surgery, there's this almost like accommodation process that happens, where the lower lip, in order to kind of meet the upper lip at its new location, kind of has to become more prominent and evert itself. So I find that the lower lip actually gets a little bit bigger, which is interesting. I don't think this has been reported in our literature, but I am finding that the lower lip's getting a little bit bigger. And so I would say 95% of my patients after an upper lip lift, even if it's a dramatic change, will not want that filler in the lower lip, whereas they may have asked about it beforehand. So it's very rare. I have some patients who still want lip filler even after a lip lift, and those patients usually are looking for just more volume. They're happy with their new philtrum, they're happy with their dental show, but they just want those bigger lips. And so we're usually putting filler then into the top lip and the bottom lip, not so much just the bottom lip to even out the two. So it's a really good question, actually. Lip filler, I mean, you guys know probably a lot about that, but again, it's something I offer in my practice, but a lot of people seek me out for the surgical option. But again, there are different ways of doing lip filler, and they're not all the same, and there's a lot of technicalities with that too. One thing I'll throw out there is that you have to know what look you're trying to create. You have to ask the patient what they want with lip filler even. And it's rare that I'm injecting into the actual vermilion border, which is where a lot of people inject. And I find that that is what creates that sort of duck look, where it gets projected and most people recognize that from a distance and don't appreciate it. So even though it's kind of the easiest place to inject, it just seems obvious. Oh, let me just inject into the vermilion and recreate sort of a natural, what's called a white roll. You can't recreate that natural appearance. If someone has a really flat appearance of their vermilion, they've lost that sort of youthful role that we all have at birth. Very, very hard to recreate that, no matter what you do. So that's just something to keep in mind with lip filler. So I'm injecting along the dry portion of the red lip, so below the vermilion, and then also into the wet part of the lip. So if I'm trying to bring the lip out or evert it, I'm injecting a little bit further down along this junction between the wet and the dry red lip. And then if I'm just trying to create a little bit more volume, then I'm doing it into the dry portion of the red lip, trying to avoid the vermilion in most cases. Now, in terms of different types of surgical lip lifts, right? So there are different types. And sometimes the terminology can get confusing. similar to facelifts, right? Which we'll have another talk about that another time. But facelift surgery, so many terms, and a lot of them mean the same thing. A lot of it's meant to kind of confuse patients or for people to promote their practices, which isn't bad, but you know, it can get really confusing. Someone asked, can a lip lift make asymmetrical lips more symmetrical? Yes. So not in every situation, but it can definitely get you more symmetrical. So for example, if the left side of the lip, the vermilion border, is just down compared to the right, what you can do is you can design the lip lift so that you're removing a little bit more on that left side and you know, in that situation, raising the side that's down more. So you can create a little bit more symmetry. But again, it depends on what it is. Some people will say, well, when I smile, my one side goes off to the side more than the other side. Can you correct that with a lip lift? The answer is no. In terms of correcting symmetry, it's for static asymmetry, meaning at rest. Once you're moving your muscles of your face, there's a lot of other activity that's going on. You can't recreate that or correct for that asymmetry with just a lip lift. And so what that means when someone's side of the face is just pulling more is that they probably just have stronger muscles on one side of the face than the other. And you know, most of us have some degree of asymmetry. And again, certain types of asymmetry can be corrected with a lip lift and others cannot. Going through other types of lip lift. So you have a bullhorn design, and that you may have seen online, and I should probably start posting this more, because I actually take a picture when I do the lip lift right before we're ready to go, and I've designed the look and all of what it will look like, how much I'm removing. I basically will take a picture, and so I've thought about posting more of these, and I probably will start doing it just so people can see what the design is. So you have the before and the after, but what was the actual marking like, you know, before you actually cut out the skin? So the bullhorn basically just means it looks kind of like a bullhorn underneath the base of the nose. And that's also called the subnasal lip lift. And in my practice, I've kind of coined my own term L lift, and that's still a bullhorn design. And you may have heard there's a surgeon out in LA, a good surgeon for lip lifts, and he calls it the modified upper lip lift. So that's also another bullhorn design. So most of the modern type of lip lifts of the upper lip are all bullhorn design based. Well, someone just asked, I've seen many people having surgery to shorten the length from their nose to their upper lip. What's the purpose of this reduction? So that's exactly what we're talking about now. So the surgical upper lip lift creates that shortened distance. And what it does is a couple of things. So shorter philtrum, again, that changes the kind of overall appearance and can create more balance between, say, the upper, mid, and lower parts of the face. It also will bring out more of the upper teeth. So then we'll have more upper tooth show, upper dental show. And you now basically evert the upper red lip, so you have more upper red lip shown. So that's the purpose of Whoa, Jesse. And hopefully that answers your question. So that's exactly what the upper lip lift is meant to do. Now, Italian upper lip lift, and what is that? So that's little excisions on the sides. So you're basically sparing the central portion. Italian lip lift. It was originally designed to reduce the amount of sort of scar that you have, so the distance, there's not as long of an incision. But the downside of the Italian lip lift is you're not distributing the tension on the closure. So what you thought would help by reducing how long of an incision you're making is actually kind of hurting you, because when you're closing the areas, first of all, it looks a bit unnatural because the center is, nothing's happening at the center. The excisions are here, so the sides are coming up, but the center, you know, is not coming up along with it. And plus the scarring ends up being worse, actually, because again, you're not distributing the tension over a longer incision. So similar concept to facelifting, actually. The thought that if we take a really short incision, then, you know, maybe we can get away with it, and then it's just gonna be less scarring. The scarring ends up being worse because you need to distribute tension over a longer incision. So that can sometimes be a problem. Gullwing incisions are made along the vermilion. So it kind of looks like the wings of a gull. No one's really doing that type of surgery anymore. That used to lead to a lot of scarring at the vermilion border, and it just looked bad. And that's one of the dangers of the next one that we're going to get into, which is corner lift. People ask me quite often, actually, well, what about, let's combine the upper lip lift with the corner lift. The problem there is that your incision is right at the vermilion border. There is an internal version of it, which I don't think is effective, but the one on the outside can create an improvement to the corners. But if you don't have great scarring, then it's going to be super visible and very hard to deal with after. And so I try to avoid putting any incisions on that area. The best way to address the corners is with a full kind of facelift mid-face, where you're really getting good lateral traction of this area. So where the corners come down after a while, they're coming down because the whole cheek complex is descending. So by repositioning it, you're able to bring the corners up. And so that's beyond what a lip lift can do. Someone says, what if I feel like the sides of my lips go downward like frowning? Is that corrected lip lift or more like lower facelift? So that's what I'm getting at. When you have that frowny kind of look and the corners are down, the lip lift will only lift what's right under the base of the nose. So if you take, right, because the incisions stop here. So if you take the sides of the incision, you kind of drop down two lines, you're not going to affect all the way out here. Doesn't mean that the upper lip is going to look frowny or silly. It never does after, at least the way I do my upper lip lifts. But the only way to truly address this kind of frowny appearance is to lift the entire cheek complex, which is what a facelift accomplishes. So that's great. So we're really kind of getting into the nitty gritty of it all. So we went through temporary and permanent options for upper lip lifts, right? So let's go through a couple of comparisons. So we have lip lift versus lip filler, right? Who should get what and when, and what's the best option for someone? So lip filler, we talked about some of its disadvantages, like projecting the lip, bringing the upper lip down, covering up some of the upper teeth.